Selamat Hari Raya Idul Fitri. I'm Jessie Chahal coming to you live from Wisma Bernama right here in the city centre, Kuala Lumpur. This is the brief on Bernama TV on today's special edition. I'll be speaking to Dr. Alwani Ghazali from the Academy of Islamic Studies at University Malaya. Then later on, I speak to Umi Kultum Shuib of SW Corp on food waste during this very special and festive season. But what's more special than anything else beyond is the fact that I have Nurdin Abdullah joining me in the studio today. Nurdin, Selamat Hari Raya Idul Fitri.
Selamat Hari Raya, Jess. Selamat Hari Raya to everyone out there as well. It's great to be in the studio, especially on a day like today.
Absolutely. I mean, we've got all of this here, which is great, but we can't eat on air, so we'll perhaps do that later. I got a couple of questions for you, though.
Sure.
What's your favorite Raya dish?
Whew.
Don't say rendang, because rendang's mine.
Okay. Wow. Actually, for me, serunding. But it has to be a little bit pedas, not too pedas. And with the right amount of nasi or nasi impit, just nice. Just nice.
So you're probably heading back after this to have that, huh?
Quite a bit of it, probably.
Waiting for that invitation.
Maybe it'll come around
sometime now, but
we'll get you there.
No problem. Yeah. But how would you describe the spirit of this very auspicious and blessed time? If you could just use one word, and I know you're a man of words, but just to describe.
For me, it's just family. Yeah. And it's all about family. And it should be all about family. But I think also what we're seeing more and more of is it's family plus friends plus community. And I think everyone's starting to share in that Raya spirit, and I think that's really kind of great to see these days.
So you've been living here in Malaysia for over 20 years.
No, it's 30 years.
30 years.
Yeah, I hit the 30 years. I know, I hit the mark. I also didn't realize.
And I must say, you are more Malaysian than some of the other Malaysians I have met. But over the years, how has your experience been? And to today, I mean, there has to be sort of a journey.
An evolution.
Yeah.
Well, I've had the ability to have Raya in KL and also some places up in Pahang, for example. And, you know, and it's just a wonderful time for, again, I mentioned earlier, family.
Yeah.
And of course, it's food. You know, and this kind of food festival that, of course, we've just spent the last month fasting. Of course, Buka Puasa has also been somewhat of a food festival sometimes. But at the same time,
you had to earn it.
you earn it. But there's nothing like food after you've not eaten the whole day.
Absolutely.
And for me, Raya, when you sit down with good food and good family, it just has another taste to it. And I think that's what I love about Raya.
Amazing. So what I find fascinating is the fact that you have converted to Islam. You so beautifully have been through this entire process and journey as well. And all that on your own accord. Mm-hmm. Many people also don't know this. Yeah. What aspects of this celebration do you find particularly interesting, or one that really tugs at your heart?
Well, I was having this discussion with my eldest son the other day, and I said, it's something like you're in a desert and you're thirsty, and someone gives you water, and that is kind of the analogy.
Quenching.
Yeah, you've solved that problem. At the same time, of course, Islam for me is a very practical religion. You know, there's so many problems in the world, and there's so many solutions that you can find in Islam. So I look at it that from a very practical perspective as well. So you've got the religious aspect, you've got the spiritual aspect, you've got the practical aspect. So there's a lot going on. And of course, Raya is that time just to sit down and enjoy, again, what I always like to talk about, sit down,
family,
spend time with family.
Family and food.
Yes.
I got it. Family and food.
Feed me, yes.
Now, okay, this is perhaps one year that more people are able to celebrate coming out of the pandemic. Of course, we had Raya last year as well, but with still some restrictions. How do you think that has all affected Muslims in the country in terms of the celebration of Raya? Mm-hmm. And have you seen people making any kind of adaptations, like virtual family gatherings?
I think we've seen some of that. I think there's still a bit of that. I mean, there's no excuse. Get in the car, drive safely, go back to see your parents, you know, if they're around. So I think when it comes to most Malaysians, I think 99.9%, whether you're Malay, Chinese, Indian, Sabah, Sarawakian,
right.
I think a lot of people are using this Raya time to go back and see their families. So it's whether whether or not you're celebrating Raya from a religious perspective, but you're enjoying the benefits of this holiday with family. So I think that's really going to be a wonderful thing for everyone this year.
So family aside, food aside, for those who are perhaps not even celebrating, but taking part in the celebration itself, what message or value do you think one should search for look up for?
For me, while we are celebrating this joyous occasion, while we're enjoying ourselves, we've got to remember two things for me. One is safety on the roads. You know, we don't want to ruin a good Raya with accidents. We want everyone to get there safely. The other is that we need to also remember there are people who while in Ramadan we fasted and maybe we only ate once a day. Actually, there are people who go hungry every day, whether it's in Malaysia or around the world.
Ramadan or not.
Yeah. So we need to recognize that that is our first responsibility, to make sure everyone eats tonight.
Yeah.
And ensuring that in a sense, it comes to my kind of food security thing that I love to talk about. But food security, like really on that personal level, we found out what it's like. Now we need to like really understand how to solve that problem.
Yeah, I'm being told it's about time for us to cut to a commercial, but I must ask you this question. If you could create an Eid al-Fitri new ritual or tradition.
A new one. Wow, I don't know, Jesse. I mean, what would you do? I mean, for me,
I would make it compulsory for everyone on the team to makan and celebrate together. Like we must do it. Like
it's Yeah.
That important.
I love it.
That way I can get my rendang and I can hang out.
I can get my serunding.
Yeah. Time for a quick break. We'll come back right after these messages. So we also speak to Dr. Alwani Ghazali, senior lecturer from the Department of Akhidah and Islamic Thought at UM. She'll talk about Eid al-Fitri together in diversity. That comes on right after this break. Stay with us. Welcome back, Jesse Chahel, Nordin Abdullah joining you right here on a very auspicious Raya occasion. Eid al-Fitri is not only significant for Muslims, but of course also holds broader significance for interfaith relations and building bridges between different religious communities. And what better time to highlight these points than now?
Yeah, exactly. Share in the celebration, share in the goodness, and I think people will understand the good side of what we're trying to achieve.
That's right, which is why we have joining us right now Dr. Alwani Ghazali, a senior lecturer at the Department of Akhidah and Islamic Thought from the Academy of Islamic Studies, University Malaya. She's joining us via Skype to delve into this. Of course, Doctor, wishing you and your entire family and of course all those at UM as well a very happy or Selamat Hari Raya.
Thank you. Selamat Hari Raya to you too.
Let's get right
Thanks
into it.
Thanks for having me.
Our pleasure. First off, what is the significance of Eid al-Fitri when we talk about the context of interfaith relations and the intention of building bridges between different religious communities here in Malaysia?
All right. Thank you for the question. Well, we have to go back to the concept of Eid itself. Actually, Eid is from the word Aada, which means to return to where, and that is to return to the state of Fitra. State of Fitra is the purity of the soul. For Muslims, there's a very clear notion. There is a very clear notion of Fitra, which is going back to the notion of Tawheed, that is worshipping Allah and giving all his rights and adore Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But when we talk about human interpersonal relation for a Muslim, it's not only about concerning his relationship vertically to Allah alone, but also how he or she manages to spread love to the human being. So by returning to the state of soul, a purity of the soul, the meaning of Eid is actually to spread love, harmony, extend the hand for those in need, and also try to be an active agent in the social setting. So in that sense, the Eid celebration is trying to gather humanity together and build bridges among different religious believers.
Now, Doctor, moving on from that, bridges between different religious beliefs, how can we promote this here in Malaysia? What can we do to improve the state of play?
I think everything starts with the Muslims understanding themselves. If Hari Raya or Eid al-Fitr is perceived as something very exclusive for themselves, and if it is perceived in a misunderstood way, in the way that it is a mere celebration of food and full stop, it's meaningless in that sense. With the correct understanding of what Eid means, okay, this can be spread to the community, shared to the community, what Bernama is doing now. It's a good way to promote this kind of a celebration, which takes into consideration the relationship between different religious believers as well.
And because we are Bernama, we're going to have to delve into this a little bit deeper. Doctor, given where we are in the country right now with the rampant use of racial, religious slurs, how can the celebration of Eid al-Fitr be used to encourage Muslims and Malaysians to engage with contemporary issues and challenges? I mean, you know, we walk out the street and all of us, we're as Malaysian as can get. Even Nordin, I have declared him full Malaysian now after 30 years here. But there are some slight tensions and there is still some issues we see. Yes. So how can we use Eid al-Fitr to encourage both Muslims and Malaysians to engage?
Yeah, I always speak about the importance of dialogue. And when I say dialogue, it means that it involves a very deep conversation between different parties, which in Malaysian context, I think we are lacking in this. We try to hide our emotions, differences. We are not open enough to challenge our differences, to challenge our prejudices. In this case, we have to move towards maturity. But to achieve that, Eid is the first door which opens a deeper platform for us to be engaged in a more honest way and in a more authentic way, I would say. So
I like what you're saying about the door, Doctor. But what can we, on a personal level, what can we talk about in terms of forgiveness and that beautiful moment in every morning in Hari Raya, you go in, ma'af, ma'af. You know, tell me more about that, and how is that significant, and how can we apply that on a national level?
Mm-hmm. Well, it's again going back to the meaning of Eid, returning to the purity of the soul. Most probably, a person mm-hmm. who worships during Ramadan spends the time day and night with reciting of the Quran and also doing the prayers. That particular aspect has been resolved in a way. But how about the sins towards human being? So there comes the act of forgiving, mutual forgiving each other, reconciliation and so on. That's on the personal level. But due to the tensions that we always have in the Malaysian context, in our Malaysian context, it is the right time for us to be open, forgiving, forget the past, move forward for a better Malaysia, and plus with a better intention not to provoke and trigger any sensitive issue in the future. I hope that this is a start for a new beginning, I would say.
Absolutely. And before I let you off, Doctor, how can non-Muslims respectfully participate or perhaps support the Eid al-Fitr celebrations between friends and even extended family, perhaps, neighbors, so on and so forth?
Simple. Just follow the general etiquette as a guest. That's all. Be respectful. And if you're invited, go attend. If you're given food, if you're offered food, eat it, enjoy together. But as both parties, I think this works mutually, both parties. When the Muslims themselves serve food, this also some concern has to be there. Meaning, all this while, the majority always think of themselves, like makanan halal, right? We always think about makanan halal to the extent that we forget that our guests also have their diet requirement. So be sensitive to the needs of others. Serve whatever the guests, non-Muslims especially, can eat according to their dietary requirement. At the same time, I'm not saying that non-Muslim guests must follow blah, blah, blah. It's open to both non-Muslims, Muslims alike, as a guest, what should and shouldn't be done. Something, general knowledge about that.
Nothing Doctor, specific. Thank you very much for taking precious time on this very special day to join us once again to you and your family. Selamat Hari Raya. Dr. Alwani Ghazali there joining us right here on The Brief. We'll speak to you soon, Doctor. Thanks for being with us.
Thank you. We're off to a quick break
right now. When we come back, we'll be speaking to Umi Kalthum Shuib, Director of Federal Territory SW Corp. We'll discuss how to keep Eid al-Fitr celebration sustainable, that by curbing food wastage. So stick around. We'll be back shortly. Welcome back. Selamat Hari Raya. Thanks for being with us. Of course, a very important, auspicious day. And we wonder if you actually have time to sit through the entire edition with us. But thanks for tuning in. Now, festivities are a time for joy and abundance. You probably have lots of food on your table wherever you are. But this time also often results, Nordin, very unfortunate, in excess of food that just goes uneaten, untouched, and ends up in the trash.
It's unfortunate. And we've got to make sure that, yes, we enjoy the festivities, but we don't waste food, which also wastes money, but also wastes the entire supply chain that everyone put their effort in to get it done. So there's a lot to think about.
That's right. Well, lucky for us, we had a chance to interview the Director of Federal Territory Public Cleansing and Solid Waste Management Corporation, better known as SW Corp. We spoke to Umi Kalthum Shuib on a food wastage, especially during times of celebration. We first asked her this question: how much food is typically wasted during festive celebrations, and what are the main factors contributing to this waste? This was her answer.
There's no evidence actually on how much food is being wasted during festival, but in short, we have a composition study of waste in Malaysia, and out of all the total waste that had been sent to the landfill, 44.5% of the waste is comprised of food waste, and 24% of the food waste can still be eaten by us, so we just throw it away and it becomes waste and it's been sent to the landfill. There are actually four types of food waste. The first one would be the waste from the canned food, which is the expired food, which we turn away. And the second one is kitchen scrap. For example, from the food preparation, so there's onion skin, fruit skin, and so on. And food leftovers is also another type. And this is considered leftovers of bones and so on. And the last type is wasted food, the 24%. So that is the food that can still be eaten. What are the factors that contributes to food waste? As you know that it does not only contributes on festival alone, it's also being contributed every day. So one of it is lack of planning, because we really lack in planning on how much food we want to buy and how much food the sellers would like to sell. All right, and this has happened a lot in Ramadan bazaars, and we can see that food have been thrown away into the waste bin, and we are also buying too much of food, so that's why it become wasted. Thirdly, there are food remainder balance which are not being stored or kept properly in the refrigerator, so it cannot be eaten already. And this balance of unsold food can also be not donated, but we didn't do it, so it become rotten and perish as well.
You know, Jesse, one of my thoughts is how much does food wastage during festive seasons like Hari Raya impact the environment?
I think that's a great question, and in fact we did check in with Umi regarding this matter. How does food waste during festive periods impact the environment? Umi has the answer.
As some information that I would like to give you, when we waste our food, we also waste all the energy and water it takes to grow, to harvest, to transport it, and also in packaging it. As land is very scarce now, we are not using our land area to grow food that is wasted. Millions of gallons of water, also oil, has also been wasted every year to produce food that is not being eaten. So it's a lot of impact to the economy. Food waste that ends in the landfills actually can produce a large amount of methane. Methane is more powerful than carbon dioxide. So it can actually produce greenhouse gas effect and absorb all the infrared radiation and heat up the earth atmospheres, and it causes global warming and climate change. Okay?
Well, of course, we also wanted to talk about some effective strategies that households and communities can use to reduce food wastage during festive periods without having to sacrifice the spirit of celebration.
Do you know that you can actually reduce the amount of food waste being sent to the landfill during this Hari Raya without sacrificing your happiness? For example, what you can do is plan the open house properly. And if you have three siblings, please make sure you do not have an open house at the three houses on the same day. You have to plan it, okay? And then you also plan on how many numbers of people that you are going to invite to your open house. And what type of food? Usually, people like to eat heavy food. So, Kuih Raya especially is an addition in Hari Raya. Thus, you can reduce the amount of Kuih Raya that you are going to serve. But then again, it's up to the appetite of the family. And apart from food, please avoid using polystyrene and single-use plastic, for example, for your plates and cups, and you can cause greater danger actually to the environment. What you can do is use all the glass plates and dishes that you have been keeping in the carpet, okay?
Wonderful. I think the key is planning at the end of the day.
Planning, right? Don't waste, think of the environment, and really start to evolve Raya to become a sustainable Raya.
Exciting indeed. And you know what? We don't have to wait for next year to do that. We can start today, Raya or not, basically.
Yes, exactly.
And any time. But this is a great time. That was, of course, Umi Kaltum Shurib, Director of Federal Territory, SW Corp. Hopefully, we have all learned a few things on how we can do our part to reduce food waste and make our celebrations more sustainable. Very quickly, we got to check what's trending on Twitter.
Yes, we do.
There are a couple of hashtags that are trending.
Yes, we're seeing hashtag Selamat Hari Raya, Salam Idul Fitri, and hashtag SHRMZB.
Yeah.
I'm not sure what that one is.
That's the full thing. Selamat Hari Raya, Maaf Zahir
get it
dan
now, Batin. Now I get it. Now I get it. Okay.
All right. Yeah. Well, basically, these have all become talking points for all the tweeps. Those are people on Twitter. Everyone's just sharing their joyous Raya messages.
Enjoy it. Go out there. Have a great time.
Absolutely. Well, we've got to run off. Nordin's chasing some serunding and some rendang.
Yep.
That's all the time we have on this edition of The Brief. I'm Jessie Chahel, together with Nordin Abdullah, wishing all of you a very auspicious Selamat Hari Raya. from all of us right here at the English Current News Affairs Desk. This has been The Brief on Bernama TV. Thank you for watching.